work at Optiv Security. And unlike everybody else, I'm a sales guy. So when Austin and Mono approached me to present, I was honestly more nervous about the pre or teach security portion of this. I was like, what could I possibly teach anybody in this room? So as opposed to teaching you guys, I want y'all to make sure that y'all understand that I'm just sharing my observations for some gaps or things that I've noticed over the last 12, 13 years in IT security with customers, leaders, and everything else that I've been a part of. So I was at Dell for 11 years. The last 5 years at Dell, I just joined Optiv last fall. The last 5 years at Dell, I worked in mergers and acquisitions, primarily on the security side. So building out pre and post work, what would become the Dell security offering. So I'm also a cancer survivor of 26 years, and I'm a member of the U.S. Paralympic Ice Hockey Team. So that's who I am, and I'm here today, obviously, to teach security or share some insight to what I see, and then teach Christ. And hopefully have some great questions and discussion afterwards. So, y'all, the worst case scenario, you guys will hopefully learn or be reaffirmed with something from Christ and then learn something about me, hopefully positive. So, y'all give me some grace on the teach security part, and I'll kick it off. So, whenever I first started trying to think about what my content would be, my beautiful wife, who is exponentially smarter than I am, was able to help me kind of corral my crazy mind into how could I merge my knowledge of Christ and the gospel and the word with the limited knowledge I have on security. So I didn't have a lot to pull from, but she just threw something at me at like 11:30 p.m. Last Tuesday night and was like, I was like, that's amazing. And I stayed up for like 4.5 hours just knocking it out. The first thing I found, once I kind of understood my content, was that there was no articles. There was no data for me to pull from. I'm a data nerd. So there was no data for me to pull from, anything anecdotal around what I'm trying to speak to. Anyways, I thought that was interesting. And I checked with all the uber smart guys that I worked with, all the ex-CISOs and so forth, and they were like, yeah, no, that's a valid point. Your whole entire presentation is definitely valid, and I can't believe there's not any articles about that. So maybe this could be something that somebody else will take and run with. But anyways, the teach security portion is winning the battle and losing the war, and tying that back into my overall content of don't get lost in micro. Always make sure that you check back to the macro level. And what I mean by that, and that's how my crazy mind works, but what I mean by that is that there's always a bigger picture with security. There's your security program, there's your architecture, there's your design, what have you aspects. And sometimes we can get lost in the weeds or on a fire or something that happens in an incident. And when we go to fix those things, we lose sight of our overall big picture, and that can have negative ramifications, obviously. Here it is, kind of a little black and white version of the security program. You know, you plan, you come together, create a plan, everybody has a plan, implement those ideas, principles, you manage it, and then you constantly assess and monitor it, right? That's the ideal textbook, I guess, version of what an IT professional leader would do every day. But the challenges of that, and this is where my observations have come in, is internal communication. You know, I spend so much time speaking to security leaders that are like, oh, that's a networking problem. And I'm like, well, no, that's a security problem. Your firewall network segmentation is a security problem. They're like, no, that's a network problem. I'm like, well, have you guys talked about it? It's always interdepartmental issues, whether it's egos, whether it's whatever it is, right, title or he had the job I wanted, or I have the job he wanted, or whatever that is. There's always issues where we can, and even myself, there's always issues in life and challenges where we can try to strive to be humble and also communicate better with other people. So that is one of the biggest challenges, interdepartmental communication. I see that throughout every single organization I've ever worked with, no matter how good or bad. Responsibilities. It's really easy that when you're in the weeds and working 18-hour days to say, that's not my responsibility, that's somebody else's responsibility. And whenever that does happen, it allows you the opportunity to lose sight of the bigger picture. You know, maybe this little problem that you don't have the time to help somebody out with could enhance or harm your overall security program if you spend the time working on it. And the budget. This is kind of goes back, budget touches everything, but the one thing I see so often is, and we have some great guys who I get to see in practice help coach CISOs or IT leaders or what have you, that it's really hard to define and articulate your need for more security or where the needs in, I guess, problems that you're solving for meet the business objectives. Or I guess to put it more simply, and somebody did an ISSA presentation about this, I think his name was Rolf Loos, who works with me. Anyways, he said that oftentimes we lose sight that we work for a business that's trying to gain money or profitability. And if we can't align the need for more security or the need to enhance processes or spend money in areas that we deem to be important, then we're never going to be able to accomplish the goal. And that ties into communication. How do we effectively communicate to different departments, such as marketing, such as sales, or such as executive leadership? And then focus. I mean, a little joke. Look, a squirrel. I mean, a new endpoint product. Last time I counted, there's 237 endpoint solutions out there, with 45% of those calling themselves next generation solutions. So we can thank Gartner for that. But it's endless. There's so many times where I'll be speaking to a customer and we're looking at a problem, we're tying that back to the program, we're solving that problem, and then 48 hours later I get a phone call like, hey, give me a quote for this shiny new thingamajig. And I'm like, well, we're already down this path. Well, no, we want to look at this. They had a good point. Marketing always has good points. Marketing always has cool slides. Marketing, so forth and so on. Sometimes somebody made a really bold claim that I didn't capture the whole quote, but he basically said, sometimes good enough is enough when you look at the bigger picture. And I think that when we get so micro-focused on individual projects or issues, life, work, whatever it is, especially in Christianity, we lose sight of the big picture and how all those tie together. So, no battle plan survives contact with the enemy. That's it, man. We spend so much time creating a plan. We spend so much time articulating our plan and our vision, and then we easily lose sight of it, like I said, 48 hours later. So, anyways, here's a practical example of kind of what I'm talking about in a real life terms, all parties anonymous at this point, but kind of like an example. Fire came up, our old AV, not adequate anymore, it's awful, we're looking for a next generation solution. Spend some time, cycles, what have you, go through the whole process of testing, getting a new solution, implementing it, rolling it out. We're narrowly focused on just the endpoint layer. And I'll try to talk a little bit more technical, but I think everybody in here pretty much gets the gist of where I'm going to go with this. But so we get that, we implement it. 6 months down the road, we have an audit. Our auditors say, you had a breach on a server that had password 123. Applications were exposed. They were able to use that server as a hop-off point. But now we're going to solve for this problem, right? Application layer, server layer, what have you. So we get a whitelisting tool to apply and roll it out to all 1,200 servers. That gets implemented, same process, what have you. Again, we're narrowly focused on that. That's where the problem comes in. 6 months down the road, customer realizes, hey, my end users, all my sales guys out in the field, are trying to access quotes that are stored in the database in these servers, and they can't get access to it. Do some investigating, we find out the endpoint product is fighting against the application whitelisting control product that is keeping those two things from being able to communicate to each other. So, now we have two competing products within our network that don't mesh together, they don't work together, not interconnected. which goes against our entire program, because we were microscopically focused on these two individual problems at these two individual times, and we didn't relate to see how those products or tools would affect our overall program or plan. Anyways, so find the issue, we see the tools aren't working together, we find some fixes, but it doesn't really a great fix. Then we find out that if we would have looked at our networking solution that we currently own, we could have easily added on some subscriptions that would have solved for this problem, given us one single pane of glass to manage all these tools from, so forth and so on. Now I sound like a marketing guy. But the point is that while that is true, everything I just said is true, right? Would it not be better off for my overall program that I want everything to give me the most visibility, to give me the most security? I spent so much time laboring on putting this plan together. Why would I get so hung up on individual point solutions that end up not working together when I could have had something that would have worked together? So, anyways, that's an observation I've made. It's a short, succinct message, but I think that we can all apply that in some way, form, or fashion in our work life. Whether we're leading a team or whether we're an individual worker bee like myself, I can do a better job of communicating customers and also my internal people to stick to my overall vision and plan of my job, which is to help all of my customers be more secure without leading this drive. So that's pretty much the gist of the teach security part. My response to that, and my dad, who's 27 years retired military officer, when he read through this last night, he goes, "Whoa, humility. You're going to talk to a bunch of gentlemen and tell them they need to be more, to have more humility." And I said, "Yeah, Dad." I said, "I feel like that as me as a leader in my job, in my life and profession, I feel that humility is a key ingredient to who makes, you know, what makes Jason Evans tick. And I feel that everybody can be reminded that we can be more, have a little bit more humility." Because humility really touches all the rest of the points for our response. How do we not lose focus of the overall big picture when we're so micro-focused on individual pains, projects, fires every single day, or the squeaky wheels? And humility definitely touches all of it, whether it's communication, right? If I told you that your life depended on it to go talk to the sales team for whatever company you represent, or marketing, even better, you'd probably be like, "Oh, I don't want to do that." Because they have stigmatism or what have you. But having humility and opening up and seeing that this might be an opportunity for you to learn something or for them to learn something from you, but those open-minded communications are always important. Teamwork is definitely important. Definitely always make sure you constantly check off, how does this individual micro-level project, problem, whatever I'm working on, how does that tie into the bigger picture of my day-to-day? Don't rush to judgment and stay the course. So, humility is definitely a big deal to me, like I just said, so I had a couple of points of reference. So, definitely, God speaks amazing words, and he tells us to be humble. He tells us to treat other people like we want to be treated, and not to, you know, even though we're tired at the end of the day, driving home from a long day at work, and we pull up, and our neighbor's outside and wants to talk to us, and we're like, "I don't want to talk to another person." Take that extra 30 seconds, say hey, and shake his hand. So, and that ties into humility, ties into communication, and it ties into practicing communication and everything else. And then I love this quote from Sun Tzu. It was the first big, cool book that I read whenever I was in college. I'm not a book reader. But strategy without tactics is the slowest route to victory. Tactics without strategy is the noise before defeat. And I read that, and it spoke volumes to me on this subject. Somebody else may read that and say, "I don't even understand how this is applicable." But I think it's definitely warranted. And then obviously, again, back to the point. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. And I think if we apply that truth to our day-to-day work, every single individual project, all throughout the day, when you rest on that, put it up in your cube or your home office, it'll help us to respond better in escalated situations, to criticism, to conflict and resolution. So that's teach security. Any questions?
Go back a couple of slides.
Yes, sir.
A couple of moments. I got one there. So it's interesting you actually put strategy in between plan operations and controls. Is there a reason you...
I'm going to go ahead and tell you that's not my job. Okay. That's our corporate presentation that our CISOs give.
Okay.
And I use that as an overlay for the example.
Yeah.
But this is the foundation of how my company is built,
right,
from the outside out to our customers, from the inside out to our customers.
Right.
So,
how is this, because usually you see strategy top level, driven down to controls. I was wondering if there was a rationale behind actually having that as the pivotal point of then.
My response is that the way that I see this is that it's a head and heart. Some people value heart more than they value head. Some people value head more than they value heart. And in my personality and the way that I see how our company is built and how we work with our customers, the heart drives the head or the arms and legs.
Okay.
That's how I do
good
it.
Good center,
yeah. Yeah.
As opposed to the top, no?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay.
Good clarification.
Yeah. Cool. Any questions? Am
yeah.
I tracking with y'all?
Yeah, good. Just go back to slides. I need to get a picture. That the response here. No, they won't have that.
One more?
One more. Dude. Keep going, keep going, keep going. Response. Yeah, that's one. All right? Good.
So, any affirmation on that topic? Did anybody gain anything from that? Is it valuable? So, I'm an extremely emotional person. So I wear my emotion on my sleeves. So I see things like that, and I immediately grab onto it. I'm like, yeah, that makes so much sense to me, and I believe that. You know what I mean? And other people are like, yeah, that makes sense. It's all good. You know. So, anyways, so teach Christ. So this is awesome. Because as I started going through the study, my wife ran to the kids' room and came back to me and handed me the children's storybook Bible. So I'm going to start off by preaching out of the children's storybook Bible. Reading the Bible as one story. The whole story is greater than the individual parts. The individual parts make up the whole story, but the whole story is the key. And in this glorious little tool, you guys ever seen any kids and want to do outreach, buy a ton of these and just start handing them out at Walmart. I'm going to read part of this just because I think it's awesome. And to think that my 3-year-old and 7-year-old, this is the foundation of their belief when we first started preaching to them and teaching them the word. There are lots of stories in the Bible, but all the stories are telling one big story. The story of how God loves his children and comes to rescue them. It takes the whole Bible to tell the story. At the center of the story, there is a baby. Every story in the Bible whispers his name. He is like the missing piece in a puzzle, the piece that makes all the other pieces fit together, and suddenly you can see a big, beautiful picture. So, I think it's awesome. And I could literally stop my presentation right there and just walk away, because it's just, it's very well said. And by the way, yes, I, for a long time, I read this Bible more than I read the actual Bible. Anyway, my kids love to read. So, why is it important, right? It doesn't matter what I think is important, it matters what the Bible says. So, the Bible specifically tells us that the Word is important, right? The physical Bible that we can touch and read and look at is the actual Word of God, and it is true. So, it's very important, right? So, understanding how do we read and use this tool, and how do we communicate with it, is vital in our day-to-day as Christians. So, multiple examples of why the Bible is important, why the Word is important, and why we should read it, and why we should spend our heart and our mind trying to get in deep with it. This one down here is a great one. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to teaching. So, I need to do a lot better on these two, and obviously, reading, I don't read nearly enough, but I think we all have room for improvement. So this is why what I'm about to talk about is important. It's biblical. So the challenge. I was able to find a lot of references for this part of my presentation. But we oftentimes break the Bible into short stories. For kids, I work in kids ministry, so I can relate to that a lot easier. But we break the Bible into comic book stories about these superheroes that are awesome. And they take down a giant, and then we leave it there. And the next Sunday you come back and we tell you about another hero, right? And the next Sunday you come back and we tell you about another cool story about how the whole earth flooded and there's this big boat with tons of animals on it. And when we do that, we don't do enough job on how we present the content. We lose sight of the overall beautiful picture of the Bible, which is the gospel story. This gentleman, Michael Gohe, did a public lecture on a long thesis, a theological study, about this very subject. Culturally, psychologically, throughout time, they've always had an issue with this. But we fragmented the Bible into bits, moral bits, systematic theological bits, devotional bits, historical critical bits, narrative bits. When the Bible is broken up in this way, there is no comprehensive grand narrative to withstand the power of the comprehensive humanist narrative that shapes our culture. There were so many amazing quotes that he had in his presentation that I couldn't throw it all up there. I'll send it to you all if you want. But he got into the sociological aspect of how we try to force our worldviews on the teachings of the Scripture. And that's false. What it should be is that we become a part of the gospel story, and we put ourselves into the overarching story of the gospel in the Bible, and not, well, how does Daniel taking down Goliath reflect today on how I'm experiencing things in my life? Well, that tells me that bullies are bad and that God protects us from bullies. Well, that's not the truth of what God's really trying to articulate in that story. And that's why it's very important that we take a step back again to the macro level and look at the entire story of the Bible and what God is really trying to teach. And how does that David and Goliath story articulate back to other stories in the Bible? And how does that ultimately point back to Jesus and our need for salvation? So we impose, again, I already said that part, we turn God's word into the telephone game. I thought this was cool. Y'all familiar with the telephone game? Everybody? I tell you a sentence, he tells him, so forth and so on. As we go around the room, when you articulate that sentence back to me, 99% chance it's not going to be the complete sentence that I said, right? And we often do that with the Bible. The entire Bible is God's word, right? So if we short cycle it to one little hit here, a little devotional sentence here, or this and that there, without making our entire presentation to the whole of the Bible, then we end up playing the telephone and we miss pieces that are very crucial. God intentionally wrote out the entire Bible for us, or God created the entire word for us to have, so that it was all together, not bits and pieces. We teach our kids that the Bible is a comic book or a superhero story that was double type, and we lose sight of the gospel. Again, because we get narrowly focused on, I need the word today to help me through this one individual problem, so I'm going to find that one scripture that tells me God says it's going to be okay, and then I lose sight of the overall big picture. And then I lose sight of myself, too. I get hung up in that one problem that I'm dealing with, as opposed to my greater salvation and the repentance that I need to do, or the walk that I need to live. So, personal example, I will self-admit that I was a terrible Christian for 95% of my life today. I'm 35 years old, and I can say that over the last 5 years, my walk has blossomed. And I have references for that in case anybody needs that. But here it goes. I'll make myself look stupid. So, the story of Jonah. You'll notice the whale is in red, and I'll tell you that why. My dad caught it last night. I was really proud of it. But micro level. So, my interpretation of the Bible was individual stories. I knew these individual stories from years of going to catechism and self-prescribed Sunday schools and what have you. But what I saw, because I had a narrow focus and understanding of the Bible, because I didn't really try to understand, nor did I really spend time educating myself on the Word. What I saw was a cool story about a guy who disobeyed, swallowed by a whale. Later, he saved a whole city. So I hope other people in here can see the gaps in that thought process. But that was my understanding of Jonah. So when I first started teaching my 7-year-old, I was like, yeah, there's a cool story about Jonah the whale. He gets swallowed by a whale. And my son's like Pinocchio? And I'm like, well, kind of like Pinocchio, but anyways. So that was my understanding of the Bible. And that is self-admitted, that was my own fault. It was my own fault for not reading and understanding the Bible and studying it better. Well, if you look at it now, years down the road, and the real story of Jonah, the entire book of Jonah from the Old Testament, is that it teaches about God's mercy and grace to disobedient people, entire city of disobedient people. And God called somebody to go save those people. And then it also teaches us about our call to lead a mission-led life. So, In the story, God's extraordinary capacity to forgive upon true repentance. When the people finally truly repented, he forgave. And it's also fundamental to our understanding. So this ties into the gospel from the Old Testament. So the Old Testament, before Jesus was born, points to the need for Jesus and what he did. So demonstrates mankind's inability to follow the Mosaic or the law of Moses or the Ten Commandments. It demonstrates God's grace and mercy. It demonstrates, despite human weakness, Jonah was a weak man, much like myself, probably a lot stronger than I am. He continuously disobeyed God. And then even after all that was over, all these people were saved. Jonah was mad at God for not killing all those people like he said he was, because he was going to look like a fool. And it demonstrates God's willingness to forgive upon heartfelt repentance. God's plan for salvation that extends to all people on the earth, and a call for us to have a mission-led life. One of the last things Jesus said before he ascended to heaven. So here's the gospel.
You were going to say something about the way of...
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Another biblical intrude, right?
Not really.
In the Bible, it says a fish. The word of God, which is true, says fish. Doesn't say well.
Yeah.
How did that just get how did it get distorted for multiple years of my life to think that that was a well?
Because
people read the Bible and applied their own cultural or situational understanding to say, oh, big fish? The only big fish that can swallow a human being is a well.
Maybe they read Pinocchio's story too.
Boom.
So
I was inspired by the whale.
Fishery,
you have an expert
here. I'm a fishery biologist, and before I came to the world of security, I used to live in the Bahamas and dive with sharks, and that's what I did for my living and research. And the fish, if you go scientifically, if you want to try to answer the biblical aspect, which science could never answer the Bible completely, if it was a fish, then the possible fishes that could actually have swallowed a man would have been the megalodon.
Right.
And so there are theories in that phase, but that's actually just a minuscule point. But I think you brought it back to the more important thing, because and that's actually interesting. So after this, go back and read about the murder that was solved by a great white, where a person was almost swallowed whole, and they found out about that murder because the guy's tattoo was still in the fish. So, but that's a different story. But I think what you hit on over here is it's good that we need to read the Bible one carefully and not interpret it according to our own intelligence, as opposed to leading the Holy Spirit into interpret what the revelation is. But it's all about that baby who was born in a manger, who's a king, who's the Lord, and who's the Master, and who's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I love the fact that you actually brought it down to the Old Testament pointing to Christ. Now from the New Testament, we're looking back at Christ, but we're also looking towards his coming again to reign and rule. So,
And to that point, so you made it abundantly clear that we have to read the Bible with intent,
right,
and then we have to study and learn. And then when you read one specific passage, you should read it in multiple versions so that you have a better understanding. Then you should apply that to other books of the Bible and how those tie together. And I know everybody in this room, because I work with people like you every single day, you guys are very process-driven, right? You want a formula to follow, right? I can't remember the gentleman's name. I'm blanking on it. He's a younger guy about my age. He presented my first Hack Formers meeting on the epistemology.
James Wickett.
Yes.
James Wickett.
And so the presentation that he has is loaded up on the site, but you can reference that, and it talks about the process of application dev, and then it talks about the process of epistemology. And you can kind of take that process and kind of train your heart on how to apply it to studying and understanding the Bible. And if that doesn't work for you, every church has a different application of how you should study and get in the Word and understand the Bible and relate it back and so forth and so on.
The one other observation I would call out to at this point is with the discussion with my son. He was like, why do we call it Bible stories? Why do Sunday school teach us Bible stories? Because it's not a story, it's a fact. A story would be a fiction or something that's made up. So I have to be careful now when talking to children, and especially my son, that it's the account according to the Bible. That's recorded by the scripture, as opposed to saying it's the story of Jonah. I'm not hitting your...
Oh, yeah. No,
it's
sure.
The account of Jonah is recorded in the scripture, right? And so, and I think that's also a kind of a deception where
your children are taught stories, and when they grow up and they're not strong in the word and they don't take time to read the word, then when they go to college and other higher education, they're confronted of their faith, and you don't have a basis, a strong foundation, because it's not a story, it's recorded and it is, you know, given unto edification.
Well, I mean, that's what Paul was talking about when he was addressing people in the books of the Bible. He was specifically saying there's so many false prophets. Because my hope is that I can teach my children, who are very young, the gospel, and that they would come to Jesus, come to God, and that they would go out and multiply exponentially, and then you spiderweb that all the way out, right? That's a good legacy for me to leave. What happens, though, is if I teach false teachings, then now my spiderweb is a bunch of false prophets. So it's very intentional. I mean, that's why we have to be very intentional with the word. We have to be very intentional with our studies of the word. Here's the gospel. Basically, the same overlay that I did with the security program, I could do here, from the macro to the micro. So oftentimes, I guess I should use this in a different example, but if you take out any one part of this, there is no gospel, right? And I'm sure that other people would articulate this in a much different fashion. I used a merge between John Piper and Wayne Grudem for how I made sure I articulated this, and I had Austin look over it and our other preachers look over it just to make sure that I spoke complete truth. But essentially, this is a beautiful, perfect story, and this is the macro of the Bible, all put together and rolled up.
The story of salvation history.
Beautiful, right? But if we take in the, if we get hung up on one individual part without the overall view, we lose sight of the overall view. That makes sense. But if we take out one single part, then it all falls apart. So, the gospel is beautiful, and I'm going to share it with y'all real quick, even though it kind of messes up my reputation, but God created the heavens and earth, our beautiful, perfect God who created the heavens and the earth. God created mankind in his image to bring glory to him. Mankind disobeyed and sinned, entered the world. Every single person from Adam and Eve on would have sin. The entire earth revolted against us. Sin entered the world. Our perfect world that God had created, or the perfect world that God had created, is now gone. So we will never see that again until we go to heaven. Or until God comes back. And then kicks him down. But that's the Old Testament. And that's why God applied the Mosaic law of Moses, and gave 10 commandments for us to follow, or try to. But again, once again, we failed as human race multiple times. God, you know, sent Noah, flood came, gave us another chance, screwed up again, constantly screwing up, not able to follow the Mosaic law of Moses. God, awesomely as he is, already knew that was going to happen, which brings us to the cross, where we needed a Savior, a perfect Savior to save us from ourselves, because we're so full of sin. But we need a Savior. God sent his only Son to save us. Jesus lived a perfect, sinless life on earth, fulfilled the law, didn't break a single rule, didn't mess up, didn't take one wrong step. He died on the cross in our place, took the full wrath of God to atone for our sin, and to get us where we can't ever be ourselves, which is following the law. Jesus defeated death and Satan, and rose where he now sits at the right hand of the Father. We are now afforded a proper relationship with our God by grace through faith. And while we have been delivered from death and hell, we must repent in order for us to get right. So we are called to action on these last two points. Piper makes a point, and I read enough Piper that I wanted to mention this, but Old Testament versus New Testament, Old Covenant, the relationship that we have with God, which was never going to be right, we couldn't follow it, and the New Covenant through Christ. So our new relationship with God through Christ. These are all the supporting references for all of those bullet points that are on that chart. So there's more, obviously. The Bible's a big book, a lot of pages. But these are just some bulleted items to kind of support what I just said throughout the Bible. And I can say that y'all all have access to the presentation, so you'll be able to look these up. Check my work for me. We are saved, but we must still repent. Again, getting back to the macro, right? We look back on a micro level and look at the gospel story and say it's amazing. And we start a big mega church. We start telling people that we're already saved. All you got to do is believe in Christ and give a bunch of money and you'll get a bunch of returns. But what happens there is that we lose sight of the macro story if we just focus on individual parts of the gospel story. Again, we focus on our salvation, we lose sight of the entire story. We lose sight of the fact that we still must repent. And specifically, we were called in the Bible in the verses that I have, Acts 3:19. Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may be sin, Christ appointed for you, Jesus. So, repent. Every day. I do that with my kids a lot. It's been one of the biggest growth moments as a dad for me to learn that a lot of my hang-ups and daddy issues, or, you know, issues that I had growing up, were because I put my dad on a pedestal. And again, we're all sinners. We all have faults, right? And I don't want my kids to put me on a pedestal. So sometimes that can be tricky, but I constantly repent to my children. And I ask them for forgiveness whenever I make mistakes. And I readily admit I make mistakes daily. So, and they remind me of that too, by the way.
hold you accountable. Huh?
Yeah, they definitely hold me accountable. They're my accountability chain. Charles Spurgeon writes, repent is the discovery of the evil of sin, a mourning that we have committed it, a resolution to forsake it. It is, in fact, a change of mind of a very deep and practical character which makes the man love what once he hated and hate what he once loved. That's a lot of words, and it's a lot to take in right now, but to tie this back into the entire picture, gotta repent. That's part of the gospel story. So don't lose sight of the individual micro. Don't get so hung up on individual micro pieces, or don't get hung up in individual snap pieces. Always bring it back to the total.
Tie it back to the original, you know, the technical side.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, I see it so often, I'm sure you do too, where you have competing groups,
yeah,
group, security group, and they're not humble at all.
Oh, yeah.
They fight with each other.
Oh,
and
yeah.
It's like, guys, we're going for the same goal. If you
on a day-to-day basis,
yeah,
I meet with the smartest man in Austin every single day, in every single meeting.
Yeah.
I hope no one of my customers are watching this. Actually, I hope they are. So, our call to action. I'm going to wrap this up because I want to bring this and tie this back into a really cool point that this ties into our day-to-day life. But Wayne Grudem, awesome quotes from him. But basically, our call to action is to repent and share the gospel. The last thing Jesus said on this earth before he arose to heaven was, go out to all the nations. So, don't be afraid to share the gospel, including kids. Like I said about the spiderweb thing, if you want to exponentially grow your legacy in Christ, kids are the first one to get it, so you can multiply it faster. So how does this apply to your life? So I'm going to get a little emotional. I've already explained that. I'm going to apply this to my life on how day-to-day we get hung up in micro things. So, I'll quit saying micro and macro. I don't know why my brain keeps saying those, but we get so hung up in the minutia of the day-to-day life, right? Whether it's, I got a speeding ticket, which I actually did a couple days ago. Shame on me. But I was very upset about that. Or whether it's my kids kept me up last night till 2:30 in the morning, and I only got 4 hours of sleep on a brand new leather sofa, and I sweat the entire night. I could get hung up in all these little things, but I lose sight of the bigger, greater thing, which is I have an amazing life. I have amazing people in my life. God has blessed me over and over again. That's how I view my life, right? And I have a perfect creator who loves me and a beautiful family. That's how I view my life. That's my view on my own personal life. However, most people don't view my life, my personal life, that way. And I'll explain to you. So, 1989, December 1st, or August something, I don't know the date on the actual diagnosis, but I found out I had osteosarcoma. Osteosarcoma is the most deadly bone cancer there is out there. In 1989, the statistics were less than a 25% survival rate, I believe is what it was. So I had the odds stacked against me, obviously. 1989, December 1st, at 6 a.m. in the morning, I lost my leg to cancer. The only way to save me. And they thought that by removing the leg with the tumor in it, that they would stop the cancer from spreading, That would be my best shot at that 25% survival rate. God had other things and plans. My Jewish doctor, awesome guy, I love him to this day. And my mom and him would fight all the time about God versus man and their being able to save me from this physical cancer that was killing my body. You look at these pictures, which is funny. You know, I was trying to show you guys examples to feel sorry for me, because some people do feel sorry. I mean, you should, but feel sorry for this little kid who had cancer, you know, but I'm all smiling and sheathing out. And that's just kind of my weird personality. No matter how bad things get, gotta make the best out of it, right? So anyways, people back then obviously felt bad for me because I was a little kid. My eye cancer caught off the leg. I think 95% of the cancer was gone out of my body, which was an amazing year. Blew all the statistics away. So here I am today, 20 some odd years later, a cancer survivor and an amputee. But what I'm trying to articulate is that even to this day, it's the funniest thing, most people don't realize I'm an amputee until I actually tell them, or until I had a really rough day at the gym or what have you, and I'm limping around everywhere. But people feel pity for me. Mostly non-believers, I feel, but just in general, people feel pity for me. Or, you know, when I share my story of what, you know, how I got to where I am today, I don't think they see the highlights. And I think that we as individuals do the same thing. We get so wrapped up in all the bads and we never see the goods. But kind of like the gospel is such a beautiful story, and there's pain and there's hurt and heartache in the gospel, but there's also beautiful, like beauty, right? And that's kind of how my story is. Like, there's definitely pain, there's definitely day-to-day challenges, and there's all this negative stuff, but God intentionally put me on earth to be who I am today, which is a one-legged man who's a little bit chubby around the midsection and losing my hair on top. But all of my experience in life has led me to who I am today. And so the people that I've been able to bring to Christ, people who have witnessed my life and gotten some sort of inspiration out of that, or people that I've helped that are going through the same challenges that I went through, or whatever it is, they wouldn't have gotten that positive message from me or any of the positive benefits if I would have never lost my leg. Most people think, did you ever think to yourself, you know, what would your life have been like if you wouldn't have lost your leg? It's like, yeah, duh, right? I was an amazing soccer player. I really was. I had a college soccer coach tell me that, you'd have got a scholarship if you'd had two legs. I'm like, oh, that's awesome. You know where the leg store is? But
Sign me up.
It's so easy for us to look back, and I can easily look back on my life, and I work with amputees, and especially a lot of soldiers who come over who were, you know, Superman, and now they lost a part of their leg, and they think that's part of their identity. The reality is that you are who you are intentionally. God's created, God's plan for us was written a long time ago. So, anyways, I think that ties in very well, and I think that's applicable to everybody, because everybody has challenges and problems greater than mine. But it's how we interpret that. How do we look at the greater work of our life from a macro level and not get so hung up on our individual levels?
I think it ties down to, as you were sharing your story, what was coming into my mind is we all actually need to be amputees.
Yeah.
The amputation of ourself and the amputation of the sinful desires that is in us is far more crucial than the physical amputation that, you know, I can never empathize with what your life was or what went through, because I've not been subject to that from a physical standpoint, but from a spiritual standpoint, at least, I can relate to, if not for Christ removing the element of sin and the self from me, I may be perfectly fit externally, physically, but spiritually, I'm just reformed.
Yeah.
Right. And that's what is important.
That was going to be the last thing I said, was that, you know, any time that I've been able to share kind of like who I am today, and whenever we get to the point of, do you ever think about what your life would have been like if you wouldn't have lost your leg? And that's what I immediately think back to. I see that person with two legs who's in full head of hair and skinnier on the waist and playing professional soccer. I see that person as sin. And I see that person as the worst version of me. I see that person with no humility. I see that person full of arrogance. All of the characteristics that have been developed through the experiences that I've had, having cancer, dealing with death at a young age, and so forth and so on, have made me who I am today. And now who I am today, I know that I rest in him, and I can't say that if I would not have lost my leg and I would not have almost died and gone through cancer, I would have been that same person. So, there we go.
So this time for open questions.
Yeah, for sure.
Observations, questions.
You guys have to have some questions.
To post to
comments.
Jason or, to the, or even comments and observations.
Was it insightful at all?
Yeah.
It was very
yeah.
good. It was interesting. If you hadn't gone through that hardship, you would become who you are. And I don't know how many other people in the room would have it, but if you had, I went through a hardship, and that's why I'm sitting here. Just real quickly. I was not a Christian 12 and a half years ago. Marriage broke up. Short version, that's how it became one. If it hadn't been for that, I would be sitting here listening to you right now.
And I think that I rest in the comfort to know that, like, no matter how bad things are going right now, it's all part of a plan. And it's a perfect plan. And it's going to end up good. Or one way or the other, you know what I mean? No matter how hard that is, it's very hard for you to see that in the moment. But it's true.
Is true. Okay, a little bit of, I guess, wisdom from my son. He had kidney cancer, and we discovered it at 16. I may get a little emotional too, but my wife said that she wished more than anything that she could take that away from him, you know, that he would not have had cancer. And his comment was, "Mom, I like myself the way I am today with the cancer better than the person I was before the cancer."
Before
the cancer.
There's. It's a hard fact.
It's
a hard fact for a 16-year-old boy who doesn't see himself as an entity to grow up around a bunch of athletes. Dad's a college athlete. You know, mom was a college athlete. Like, it's a hard fact to see that, like, there's a definite limit. I would slap myself hard for saying that just right there. But there we only put limits on ourselves. But it was a hard fact to try to understand that and grip that at a young age. But it's true.
Talking about cancer, I was talking to a friend of mine over this past weekend who's going to MD Anderson to do some cancer research, and he kind of drew in me he's a believer, and drove in me a very interesting perspective, where he said that we research to figure out this solution to a physical ailment. But his thing was, he was saying, I do this because it gives him an opportunity to really show others that he communicates and works with that sin is the true cancer in life, right? And it proliferates unto death. And so it's an important, you know, insight that I gained this past weekend about how we ought to be careful. All of us have that situation, and Christ the surgeon is the one who can remove it. It's by our own, if we follow the law, or by our own efforts and what we do, say that we do all the exercise routines and we do everything that we need to do to make ourselves healthy, cancer is not going to go away with exercises, right? So the same thing happens with life in terms of going to that master surgeon, and Christ is that master surgeon, and he came, died, rose to give us that life, to really excise us from sin. So.
Yeah, I mean,
there are other words of scripture that say you can, don't be afraid of what can kill the body.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, at this moment, cancer entered the world. At this moment, divorce entered the world, hardships, pain, death, loss. And in my awakening, in my walk, that hit me hard, right? Because now I could pin it back on something. You know how many times people were like, well, how'd you get cancer? What caused it? There's no answer, right? But I can point it back to this, that darn fruit, stupid apple. But
wasn't an apple.
Actually, it wasn't an apple. Your dad would call you out on that. It wasn't an apple.
Yeah. But yeah, so.
And that's a good point, actually, this gentleman. What's up? Do you mind me name again?
Alan.
Alan, yeah. So Alan talks about, like, don't be afraid of what can actually kill your body. Do nothing to your soul, right? So.
Keeping the eye on the big picture.
Yep. Yeah. That would be a good quote. I should use that one. I can update this. I'm going to try to build this out a little bit more. So, anyways.
Good job.
Thank you.